Mr. Niranjan Hiranandani. Mr. Ranjan Mandelkar, Shri Ashokji, Shri Mubalji, all members of Meritco, Chief Engineer DP, Chief Engineer Building Proposal, CFO, officers from the corporation, and all present here. When I was listening to Niranjan, he said that now PIATA has produced a second version of DP. And I was wondering to myself, ये बिचारी डीपी क्या है आजकल तो महाभारत का भी वर्षन निकल रहा है. इफ यू सी द ओरिजिनल महाभारत नाउ यू हैव अ वर्षन विच इज कॉल्ड अर्जुनस व्यू ऑफ महाभारत, देन यू हैव अ द्रौपदीज व्यू ऑफ महाभारत, देन यू हैव श्री कृष्णस व्यू ऑफ महाभारत. सो महाभारत इटसेल्फ हैज सो मेनी वर्षन्स एंड सो मेनी व्यूज. आई थॉट इट इज अ रामायण विल नॉट हैव, बट नाउ देयर इज अ बुक विच सेज रावणस व्यू ऑफ रामायण. बट दिस ओनली शोज वन थिंग, the embedded democracy in this country. It's historical, the democracy. And that is something that we need to respect. There is nothing that is the last word. Everything has another version that will come out. So the minute you think you've got the last word, that is the end. Nothing can have a last word. The Mahabharata and the Ramayana has no last word. What is this poor DP? Let the versions come. Let me assure you that we'll take everything on board. Before I go on, first thing, what is the DP all about? It's a 20-year plan which will lay out the economic, the environment, and the social roadmap for the city. And this is something that is mandated by law. When we started making the DP for Mumbai, we said, let us see what is the paradigm that we have to work under. Ye boundary kya hai hamare paas? What is the boundary under which that I have to work? The first boundary and the restricting factor that we found, there were two of them. Fundamentally, after a lot of discussion, it boiled down to just two things. The first boundary that we have is land. The uniqueness of Mumbai is the shortage of land. Out of 470 odd square kilometers in Mumbai, 72% of Mumbai is no. You can do nothing with 72%. 30% is natural area, the mangroves, the CRZs. 20% goes in reservations. About 12% is roads. 9% is a special planning area that, of course, in some time will come back to the corporation, but at present, corporation doesn't touch it. 1% is RA. So 72%, you can do nothing about it. You are just left with 22% of Mumbai on which you have to do your commercial residence, your FSI, and whatever you want to do. It's just 28%. If you look in terms of area, the area per person available in Mumbai is about 37 square meter per person, is the area available in Mumbai. Out of that, 26 square meter per person is locked. Reservations, roads, natural areas, RA. So hardly you are left with about 10 square meters in which you have to provide the commercials and the residentials. This is the first restricting factor that you have to work with. The second restricting factor we found was the population. And if you see the population trends of Mumbai, there's a very skewed trend. If you see from 2011, the latest census that is there now in the market, we have a population of 12.44 million, that is 2011 population. 2021, we are projecting a population of 12.79, it will go up. And 2034, that is the year in which this plan ends, that is the planning period of 20 years, 2034, the population will drop to 11.4 million. So while the population rises to 12.7 in 21, by 34, the population will drop to 11.4. But while planning, we decided that we must take norms for a population of 12.7 million against 12.44, that is as per the 2011 statistics, so that you have a much more comfortable planning. You know, we are always blamed in the government ki dekho wo angrez kya marine drive bana gaye aaj bhi chalta hai aur aap kya banate hain wahan par ek gaadi bhi gayi to traffic jam hota hai. So this time we said let us plan for the highest population that will touch. After that the population drops, we will take into account how it drops. But if you see this, 81 to 91, Mumbai saw an amazing growth of 38% The decadal growth was 38%. That's one of the highest anywhere in the world in terms of demographics. That was 81 to 91, that decade. From 91 to 2001, Mumbai grew at about 20.4%. Again, a very high decadal growth by any demographic standards. Fortunately, from 2001, we are seeing a slowdown in growth. And till 2011, we are now noticing that Mumbai is growing at only about 3.87%. So from 38%, the growth has now dropped to 3%. The credit doesn't go to the family planning program. Credit goes to a lot because of the development of the MMR region. The 9 corporations and the 8 municipalities that have come up in the MMR region, Thane, Mira Bhayandar, New Mumbai, these are the areas that have started absorbing huge chunks of population. And that is throwing up the challenge of transport. That is why you see this huge emphasis on transport. Metro, the coastal highway, the second corridor for the trains. There's a huge emphasis on transport because population is moving away to these satellites and they will be coming into Mumbai to work. Therefore, you see a drop in population in Mumbai, whereas you see an increase in population in the MMR region. So transportation therefore finds a huge place in this DP because it's not just land use planning, it's also transport planning which goes with it. Now, when we decided to DP, we said the first thing that we must keep in mind is the commercial primacy of Mumbai, and that is something that cannot be lost. We have been known to be the commercial capital of the country. We shall be known as the commercial capital of the country. Not only that, Mumbai now is moving towards the status of becoming the commercial capital of Southeast Asia. It's not just going to be limited to India. And you can see the growth coming very, very quietly, but it is coming. Today, if you see, people say IT, Bangalore has done well. Today, if you ask me what kind of work Andheri is doing in terms of IT, is amazing. Animation. Huge work happening in animation in Mumbai. News gathering. People didn't even think about this as a business. News gathering, collating, coordinating, and then distributing news the world over is happening in Mumbai very quietly. Huge studios coming up, huge work benches coming up where news is collected from the world, reactions are made, put together and then sent out back into the world. That's happening from Mumbai. So slowly you find, you know, legal. The kind of legal work that's happening in Mumbai is again amazing. So slowly Mumbai is converting into a service hub. So creation of jobs and keeping Mumbai's primacy in terms of the commercial capital of this country and finally the commercial capital for anything that happens in Southeast Asia, we need to get the commercials correct. If you see the commercials, a person needs about 10 square meters for work and about 2.7 square meters for ancillary, the canteens, etc. So every job that you create, you need to create 12 square meters of space. And when we look at the population growth, we find that by 2034, we need to create 8 million jobs. If you have to create 8 million jobs, and mind you, Mumbai is not going to create jobs where you simply dig a pit and fill up a pit. These are going to be high-class jobs. High-class in the sense, in terms of service industry, in terms of hospitality, in terms of tourism. High-class jobs where educated people, people of a certain degree of skill, get employment. To do this, we need to create space of 12 square meters per person for about 8 million jobs. That takes us to 10,000 hectares. 10,000 hectares of built-up area is what we need. When we work this backward, we realize that the only way to achieve this is to get an FSI of 5 for commercial. Suddenly, you find a lot of criticism. Arre, builder ko de diya FSI. By the way, Niranjan, aapne aapko builder bolna band kar. It looks like a bodybuilder. Log dar jaate. भाई मार देगा निकाल देगा फेंक देगा बॉडी बिल्डर नहीं नो कॉल योरसेल्फ अ डेवलपर कॉल योरसेल्फ एन एंटरप्रेन्योर कॉल योरसेल्फ द हाउसिंग इंडस्ट्री बट यू बिल्डर बोल रहा हूं लेट्स क्रिएट एन एफएसआई ऑफ 5 सो वी सेड एफएसआई ऑफ 5 फॉर कमर्शियल फॉर आईटी फॉर बायोटेक्नोलॉजी एंड वी आल्सो गॉट अ चेंज फॉर होटल्स. Presently, you are allowed a higher FSI in hotels only if you are 5-star. A place like Taj will get a higher FSI. But a small hotel on an individual plot will not get that FSI. With a lot of these startups coming, a lot of young crowd now traveling, we realize there's a huge scope and a huge business emerging for what is called the actual business traveler, who comes, stays the night, he neither uses the pool nor the spa nor the restaurant, he stays the night, picks up his bag, goes off in the morning. These people need budget travel, they need budget hotels, and unless you have budget hotels in Mumbai, there's no way you can get business going. So we said individual plot, 5 FSI, whatever style you may have. So let's push the commercial availability up. That is one of the ways to reduce cost, increase availability, and bring in more business into Mumbai. Having looked at the commercial, the next thing we realize is the biggest crisis that Mumbai faces today, and it's an absolutely disastrous crisis, that is housing. Mumbai's per capita income, or Mumbai's economic generation, the wealth generation of Mumbai, is twice the national average. We generate twice the national average in terms of the economic activity that we do in Mumbai. In spite of generating twice the national average, 50% of Mumbai is in slums. 22% of Mumbai is living in cess buildings. 70% of Mumbai is living in housing which cannot be called housing. This is something that we need to do and do quickly. So before we looked at housing, we said let's look at the income profile of Mumbai. Today, 25% of Mumbai earns 12,500 rupees per month. 25% of Mumbai is at 12,500 rupees per month. Only 9% of Mumbai earns 60,000 rupees per month. And the median income of Mumbai, the median income, is 20,000 rupees per month. And if you take affordable housing, which is about 4 to 5 years of your income, 4 to 5 years of your income, it comes about 14 to 15 lakhs. Today you can't buy a one bedroom flat in Mumbai for 15 lakhs. That means what? 50% of Mumbai cannot buy affordable housing. Affordable housing is not available to 50% of Mumbai. What do you do in a situation like this? Are we saying that we have jobs, but we have no houses for our people? You must live in the slums to work in Mumbai? No. You need to see that this median population, which is earning 20,000 per month and can afford something like 15 to 20 lakhs for a house, should be able to buy a house in about 4 to 5 years of working. And therefore, you need to create affordable housing. How do you create this affordable housing? And Niranjan just said something which I must recall for you. The only way to create affordable housing is to make land cost zero. That's why Niranjan said, I'll set up an NGO and at the cost of construction, we'll give it to you. If you ask me what is affordable housing? The affordable housing is where you can get a house at cost of construction. If you have to make land cost zero, what is the option before the government? The option is twofold. One option, let's open up lands that are locked. Second option, let's acquire land from the private. When I look at acquiring land from the private, with the new Land Acquisition Act, you need to pay almost 2.5 times the SDRR rate to acquire land, which makes it a very, very expensive proposition. Today, to create housing, if you look at housing situation in Mumbai, we are already short by 0.8 million houses, and by 2034, we will be short by 1 million houses. To get 1 million houses, we used to have earlier an area that each person will be given an area of 9 square meters, was the average for affordable housing. Now we are saying it is 27 square meters on an average that we should give for affordable housing. If I say 27 square meters, 1 million housing, that means I need 10,000 hectares of built up area just to provide affordable housing. And if you were to acquire this land, make the land cost zero, construct the house and give it to the people, it is unaffordable for either the corporation or the government. So the only way that was available to beat this housing problem, which is an absolute crisis in Mumbai, we need to open up lands. So we looked at NDZ. Now people say NDZ, you pull the air. It was not never development zone. All it said was future development zone. And when you look at NDZ today, 30,000 hectares of NDZ is available in Mumbai. Out of 30,000 hectares, 10,000 hectares is under mangroves, CRZ, natural areas, hill slopes. So we said 10,000 hectares we won't touch, and we froze it. Niranjan doesn't like it, he is not happy because of that. So 10,000 hectares we froze. We were left with 3,000. Out of the 3,000 hectares, 600 and odd hectares is already encroached. So you are left with hardly about 2,300. So we said, okay, 2,100 hectares, let us put into housing. Let us give these people, if you want to come into development, one third for housing, one third green, one third is yours. We give you FSI for your area, build houses for us, we give you TDR against that, so that at the cost of construction, you can get houses and you get affordable houses for the people where the land cost becomes zero. So this is the reason why you look at the component of NDZ. The other thing that we said was salt pan. Salt pan is nearly 2,100 hectares held by Government of India. And there is a huge discussion whether it should be opened, it should not be opened, how it should be opened. So we said, let's open it for what is called the larger cost, that's affordable housing. That is something that you cannot fault us for. So we are saying, if you want to open up salt pan, open it up so that this huge pool of land comes into public hands. It must come into public hands. This is a huge pool of land that the government is holding. Government holds lands, government holds so many things. But government's activity must go in the larger public good. So if we have to open up this, 2100 hectares of land that we are holding, we said let's open that up. Under 2100 hectares of salt pan, 1700 hectares is under, any case under CRZ. So we can do hardly anything about it. We are left with about 400 hectares. So in the plan we have said that even if I can get 150 hectares into the housing market, so 150 hectares here and about 2700 hectares in the no development zone, that gives us about 2900 hectares. That should create a good housing stock till 2034 where people can say, yes, I can get a house, I can buy an affordable house. Otherwise today what are we doing in slums? We are saying, yes, we will redevelop slums, but redevelopment means what? A sale component. Says, again, there is a sale component. So what happens is about 70% of Mumbai is entitled to free housing to be afforded by the other 30%. That is pushing up the cost of housing. So what are we saying? You stay in slum, I'll give you a free house. But if you want to buy a house, honestly, you can't. Therefore, we said, let's open up NDZ so that people at the end of their careers, at the end of their job lives, can end up buying a house which is affordable to them. The next thing we looked at was that there has to be quality of life. You have your jobs, you have your houses, the next thing is quality of life. Quality of life is in terms of schools. The quality of life, schools, hospitals, this is one great issue that we need to create, because you can't have jobs and houses, but no quality, there's no hospital for you to go, there's no school for your children, there's no open spaces. So we looked at the norms and we said, this time around we need to push this up. We can't go on the way we are going. In fact, if you ask me, Mumbai is not doing very badly on the quality of life index. We are still much better than most of the places. If you see, almost 95% of Mumbai residential areas have access to a municipal school within 1 kilometer of their place of residence, which is very good by any standards. Yes, we need to improve the quality of municipal schools, we need to bring up more schools, but today 95% of Mumbai has access to a municipal school within 1 kilometer of its place of residence. Similarly, if you look at hospitals, 60% of Mumbai today has access to a municipal healthcare center, a hospital or a maternity home within 2 kilometers. Not very bad, good by any standards. Similarly, if you see open spaces, 99% of Mumbai has access to an open space within 1 kilometer of its place of stay. Yes, the quality of open space, how big is the open space is an issue, but there is an access. So if you see medical health, schooling, and open spaces are within 1 to 2 kilometers of nearly 90% of the population, which is not bad. What we need to do is improve the standards. That is what the emphasis was. This is when we said that for education today, if you see, we have an average of about 0.6 square meter per person for education. We've decided that push that up to 1.5. We really need to get education up, and education this time we said is not just primary, secondary and college, it also means skilling. Skilling is the word now. Unless you have a skilled population, you really cannot push economic activity. So 0.5, we are thinking of raising it to 1.5. Health is 0.15 square meters per person, we are pushing that to 0.4. Social, that is cemeteries where all of us will finally reach. And of course the markets, it's 0.16, we are keeping it at 0.6. The biggest change that we are making is in open spaces. Today open spaces on an average are between 1 to 2 square meters per person. We are now taking a norm of 4 square meters per person, and there's a huge push towards increasing open spaces, quality of open spaces. Finally, after having looked at the jobs, the housing, the social issues of hospitals, schools, open spaces, the next thing that comes to mind is social equity. Like I said, equity is important. There is a group in the population which doesn't move as fast as everybody else. You can't say Mumbai is only for people who run marathons. And for others who can't run, bad luck, starve. Mumbai is for everybody. If you see the working population, women for example, gender issues in Mumbai, I was surprised when we were making the debate, when this statistics came to me, I was myself very surprised. In Mumbai, only 16% of the women are in the workforce, which is amazing. I thought Mumbai should have the highest number of women in the workforce. It's not so, only 16% of the women are working. This is something which is just cannot go on for long. We need to get more and more women in the workforce. We placed a target that by 2034, we must at least see 25% of the women in the workforce. If you want to see 25% women in the workforce, do you have rental housing for women? No. So if a lady comes in to work into Mumbai, where does she stay? Does she have safe housing? No. Once you provide housing, the next thing is, what about daycare centers? No. Do you have public conveniences? No. Do you have public toilets for women? No. So we decided this time around, let's have a big push on that. So we decided to create rental housing for women, almost one in every ward, so that we get women into the workforce. As far as public conveniences are concerned, this time around 25% of any public conveniences that will be created will be exclusively reserved for women. In fact, I keep telling my people when they say, women's toilet nahi, I said one way of doing this is some men's toilet attack is to women kar do, dekho kaise hota hai. We need to push this. So this time around we have said 25% of the toilets or any public convenience that is created will be exclusively reserved for women. Similarly, if you go further, what have we done for the aged? Now they're not called old age homes anymore. Nobody wants to be known as old. Niranjan, am I correct? Everybody wants to be known young. So we don't call it old age homes anymore, we call it assisted living. Assisted living is an issue. Today we've not created anything for assisted living in Mumbai. We are now looking at assisted living one per ward. We are putting in reservations to create assisted living one per ward, so that this becomes a part of our life that comes up, so that the old, the people who are infirm, who've lived productive lives, can live lives of dignity as they grow old. The last thing that we were looking at was the differently abled. People on wheelchairs, people who are blind. What are we doing for them? So this time, specifically in the DCR, we made compulsory provisions on how the roads will be, how the footpaths will be, how open spaces will be, how buildings will be, so that they become disabled friendly. The blind, the people on wheelchairs, people who are suffering from disabilities are able to enjoy economic lives to their fulfillment. That's equally important. So social equity was something which formed great emphasis in this DP. We said the DP cannot be just for people who can run, but others who might get left behind should also be inclusive in this DP. That was the other issue that we looked at. Now everybody would say, oh well, very nice dream. Are you going to implement this dream? As of now, our reputation of implementing dreams is bad, to say the least, and in actuality, disastrous. 1964 was the first DP that came out from Mumbai. 1964 DP, we have been able to implement only 18%, dismal 18%. 1991 was the next DP that came out, that we have been able to implement only 23%. Now we have the 2034 DP, what are we going to implement, how much are we going to achieve in this? When you look at the cost of implementing this DP, it's mind-boggling. So when we looked at the cost of implementing this DP, we found that it is going to cost us 14 lakh crores of rupees. Impossible. We have to acquire almost 59 million square meters of space to build all this. That acquisition cost is impossible. So we said, look, you can't have a DP which is a dream. A DP must convert to reality. So where are we going wrong? The first thing that we are going wrong is that this cost is unaffordable to corporations. They cannot. How do you reduce the cost? The only way to reduce the cost is to get what is called partnership. Unless we partner with you, there is no way that we can. So this time around we said, we came up with the concept of accommodation reservation. We did two things by that. So if you have the reservation of a park or a playground on your piece of land that you own, you keep 30%, give us 70%, on that 30% we'll give you your full FSI, if you develop we'll give you some additional FSI, so that, and we allow you TDR, and we make TDR available throughout the city instead of just going north. You can take it anywhere you like, of course, based on the SDR rates. So we did two things by this. One, we've reduced the economic pressure on implementing the DP, the financial pressure. Two, every time you put in a reservation earlier, people would come and stand on your door, ye kya kar diya, kya dushmani nikali kya mere se. Dushmani nahi nikali, this time around, people are only too happy to hand over. Yes, there is a psychological issue ki bhai ye meri zameen hai, isme reservation kyun. But we are ensuring that you don't face an economic loss. We will see that you don't face an economic loss. Whether you have a reservation of a park, a playground, a school, a hospital, whatever, you should be only too happy to hand it over. That's why this time around we put in very relaxed TDR conditions over there. That is one thing that we have tried to do to achieve this. The second thing we found, that DP is made with a lot of excitement. And after the initial excitement and its approval, everybody disengages from the DP. Everybody then looks only at the DCR. DP consists of three things. It consists of the DP report, it consists of the DP plans, and it consists of the DCRs. The first two are lost. Only the DCRs we get stuck. The corporation is busy interpreting DCRs. The building industry is busy trying to find a loophole in the DCR. Courts are trying to arbitrate between the two, and the government is looking at it as a referee. Somewhere we need to get out of this. That is not just DCR. So what we did this time around, and that's a big exercise that's going on now, very quietly. People think DP ka kaam ho gaya khatam, nahi. The planning team now is doing what is called breaking up of the DP into 5-year plans. So now instead of having a DP which is a 20-year plan, which after at the end of 20 years, 20, 34, you suddenly get up and say, are ye to 30% hi implement hua. Every 5 years, we will have to look at what, how much we have implemented and how much we have achieved. Not only that, we are also planning that this time around, the development plan, development of the development plan, will be the first charge on the corporation funds, so that corporation funds actually flow into the DP. Because unless we do this, we neither create jobs, nor housing, nor social equity, and neither will we be able to get what is called the equity issues into place. So that is the second thing that we are doing. The last item that we want to touch, while doing this DP, what weighed on our minds in a big way? One of the biggest things that was weighing on our mind was the ease of doing business. And we looked at the earlier DCR and said, where is it that we are going wrong? Why is this happening? We realized two, three things. One, we realized that there were definitions which were very weak. And when you have a weak definition, net plot area, gross plot area, this minus that, whenever you have a definitional problem, there is a problem of interpretation. Whenever there is an interpretation issue, an arbitrage automatically arises. And that arbitrage is harmful both for the industry and for the government and the system. The arbitrage must be. So we tightened up a lot of definitions. The second area we realize that we've slowly converted the commissioner into a Santa Claus. In fact, the World Bank came and told me, I said, are you calling me Santa Claus? That I come and hand out gifts. Oh, Niranjan is my friend. Where is the gift from here? Mr. Dubal is not my friend. No gift for him. His house I will land through the chimney. Give him a gift. Let's cut these concessions out. We managed to reduce concessions by nearly 50% this time. Let everything be straight, transparent, and as I call it, correctly interpretable. It should be correctly interpretable. It cannot be subject to what is called tax planning or what is called interpretation of DCS. That is something that we need to tighten up. That is the other thing that we then, the third thing that we are looking at is a maximum amount of delegation that can take place so that the ease of doing business comes in. A building permit approval should not depend upon your kundali, but should depend upon the law. मतलब जब DPA approval के लिए अगर आप plan डालते हैं तो पहले अपनी कुंडली पढ़ लीजिए कि ये approve होगा या नहीं होगा. It should not be that. It should depend on your exactly on the law and it should go through straight and slow. To conclude and close, let me say that this was one major effort that's been done by the staff and engineers of the corporation. I'm extremely proud. Whenever my people come to me and say, sir, iske liye consultant laga dete hain. Sorry if there are consultants here. I said, consultant kya karega? Tumhari ghadi dekhega aur tumko hi time batayega. Isse acha to khud hi kaam kar lo. So this time around, this is the first time around that we've done such a massive task by our own people. I'm actually very, very proud about the Chief India, his team, the Chief Fire Officer, everybody worked very, very well. The second thing that we did in this DP, and I must say that I got the support of my people in a big way. We said, as we make the DP, we shall put it in public domain. Let people look at it, let people react. So that there is nothing confidential. In the government, we are very fond of making everything confidential. To special extent, we read that paper, I give my confidential. No. Now, as we made the DP, let it go out in public domain, let it be discussed, let people come out and say what they want to say on this. And lastly, I must thank Mr. Jha for the kind of effort that he's put in. He's almost written the whole book. It is one amazing kind of work that he has put in to do this. And of course, you know, the various associations involved in the building industry, whether it is NAREDCO, whether it is PIARCA, whether it is MCHI, and as individuals, have come forward and given us a lot of suggestions that we have done. The DP is now going through the process of what is called suggestion objection, which ends on the 29th of July. From then onwards, there is a 7-member planning committee that will look at each of the suggestion objections, give their reports, and from there it goes to the general body, which will debate, which will look, discuss, then they will have what they want to say on that, and finally it goes up to the government after 2 months. Around November, December, we expect the DP to go up to the government for its final publication. Thank you so much. I'm told that you've been listening to all this for 4 hours now. Thank you so much for this patient hearing. Wishing you all the best.
Can it be a roaring thunder of applause, guys? That was very kind of him to give us such a wonderful time. He's taken out the time from his very busy schedule.